Bam!
Mr. True, in this video we're going to do two examples of condensing logarithms, but you say, they're so easy. I'm bored with condensing logarithms. Well, we're going to look at some two fun problems today. A little bit more interesting, maybe more advanced than you're even seeing in your math book, or maybe like if you're in my HL IB math class, you'll think, I got these. No big deal. Properties of logarithms. Well, we're first going to review our three properties here. The log base b of m plus log base b of n, remembering that you get exponents from logarithms, and when do you add exponents? When you multiply under a common base. So that's equal to log base b of m times n. We have log base b of m minus log base b of n is equal to log base b of m divided by n, and the log base b of m, which is an exponent, then raised to another exponent. We can remember our properties of exponents where we can bring that stacked exponent down and move it out front, so it's equal to n times log base b of n. Now this is only two examples, but as always, you'll find timestamps in the description. You'll also find a link to my YouTube channel and my website where I have my videos organized by class and within each individual class or subject by chapter. Okay, so we have here log of 6 factorial minus log of 5 factorial plus log of 4 factorial plus or minus log of 3 factorial plus log of 2 factorial. And this is something that advanced math books like to do is, hey, look, we learn all these individual things, these concepts, these properties, these theorems, such and such, and a lot of textbooks, they kind of like just look at that one section and then move on and you never look at it again. Well, here, we're working with properties of logarithms and condensing logs, but as you look inside our sort of complicated looking expression here, you see something that's popped up that might throw you off a little bit. Factorials. Well, let's actually remember that n factorial, I meant to say let's not forget, n factorial is n times n minus 1 times n minus 2, and you continue that multiplication down until you get to 3, 2, and 1. So you just multiply by whatever that number is, and then you reduce by 1 until you get to 1. So you may be able to write this expression in completely condensed form in simply one step. Well, if that's the case, you're probably already bored with this video and you've moved on, but breaking this down little piece by piece, one step at a time, when you subtract exponents, you do subtraction of exponents when you divide under a common base, and these are common logs, so they're log base 10. So we have log of 6 factorial divided by 5 factorial plus log of 4 factorial, I'm just going to do one step at a time, minus log of 3 factorial plus log of 2 factorial. And I think maybe a mistake that some other students would have beyond just seeing factorials and this problem looks kind of complicated and just freak out and skip it is order of operations, as simple as that seems, please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. There are not really, like 6 steps or that you go through in order of operations, I don't know where that went. It's parentheses first, then exponents, then multiplication and division. That's in the same step, and you do whatever comes first as you go left to right. So don't accidentally do the addition part of the condensing and then take care of the subtraction afterwards. Because again, you get into addition and subtraction, you don't really add before you subtract. It's whatever comes first as you go left to right. Okay. So we have log of 6 factorial over 5 factorial. Well, I don't want to take up too much space as we do this problem, so let's not forget that 6 factorial is 6 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1 over 5 factorial. 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, and anything divided by itself is going to cancel. So the log of 6 factorial divided by 5 factorial is just going to be the log of 6. Okay, I just copied down the rest of the problem after the log of 6 plus log of 4 factorial minus log of 3 factorial plus log of 2 factorial. Now, in my next step of condensing this logarithm, I'm going to go ahead and do two steps. where I'm going to do the addition of these two logarithms, and thus I'm going to write one log with 6 times 4 factorial. I'm going to go ahead and combine that with the minus of log of 3 factorial, just to show you that, and not do everything in one step, but show you that you can do these a little bit quicker, but I would suggest that you don't do that until you're extremely, extremely comfortable with it. So when do you add exponents? When you multiply like base. So we have log of 6 times 4 factorial. And now this is going to be the condensing of these first two terms, and then minus that log of 3 factorial. Well, we're going to be able to bring that 3 factorial down into the denominator with that subtraction of logarithms is a log of a division. So log of 6 times 4 factorial divided by 3 factorial, and then plus the log of 2 factorial. So I went and just did one step in the first line, and now I'm doing a condensing of, instead of two terms, three terms. And we could have done the whole thing all at once, but again, just trying to show this one step at a time. So our 4 factorial over 3 factorial off to the side is going to be just a shorter version of what we've already done with 6 factorial over 5 factorial. Here we have 4 factorial over 3 factorial. And everything after the 4 in the numerator, the 3 times 2 times 1, is going to get canceled by that 3 factorial in the denominator. So we're looking at the log of just 6 times 4, and then plus the log of 2 factorial. So writing that now, again, when do you add exponents? When you multiply with that like base again. So we have the log of 6 times 4 times 2 factorial, which is really just 2 times 1. And our final answer, 6 times 4 is 24, and 24 times 2 is 48. So we have the log of 48. And just to be really careful, double check. Okay, there we go. So we're going through a book, we're working with condensing of logarithms, those properties of logarithms, and if a question pops up that happens to have factorials in it, it doesn't work any different. You're still using those properties of logarithms, just when appropriate, when you go to simplify, then you remember that your n factorial is a multiplication, you know, of factors going down by 1 until you get to 1. It's okay if you get a question that looks a little bit harder. You should still be able to handle that. Let's get on to the second example right now. I know you can. So for our second and last example, we have log of square root of 5 minus the log of the 4th root of 5 plus the log of the 8th root of 5 minus the log of the 16th root of 5 plus dot, 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 dot. And the directions are not to just simply condense the logarithm. The directions don't even say condense the logarithm at all. It just says evaluate the series. Okay, so if you're at this level of mathematics, and you're not just watching this video for fun, and you're working in your textbook, you could be doing problems, evaluating or condensing logarithms, or expanding them for that matter, and see some patterns show up that you'll recognize from, say, precalculus or algebra 2, where we have the partial sum of an arithmetic sequence, which is S sub n, n number of terms in your sequence, is equal to n divided by 2 times a sub 1, the first term in your sequence, plus a sub n, the last term in your finite sequence. A partial sum of a geometric sequence, and let's not forget, an arithmetic sequence is found by starting with a first initial term, and then you constantly add by the same value or common difference. A partial sum of a geometric sequence is S sub n, certain number of finite terms, is equal to a sub 1 times 1 minus r raised to the n power divided by 1 minus r, where r is that common ratio. So maybe you have a sequence of numbers like 2, 6, 18, 54, where you're, say in that example, constantly multiplying by 3. And then you have a sum of a geometric series, which is S, the infinite sum. Now the difference between a sequence and a series is a sequence has a set number of terms, whereas a series, well, goes on forever. That infinite sum is equal to S is equal to a sub 1 over 1 minus r when the absolute value of r is less than 1. That's the only time this gives a valid answer. So unless you have finished, let's say in the textbook I teach from, the 9th chapter of Calculus BC or Calc 2, where you're learning all your these types of nth root tests, and you start learning about Taylor polynomials and Maclaurin polynomials and series, if you will, where you're doing a bunch of tests of root tests, comparative tests, yada, yada. If you haven't learned about series, infinite series, then the fact that it says evaluate the series means that this problem it really needs to fit into the only tool that we have, if you haven't kind of got to the end of Calc 2 again, where we need to identify some kind of geometric series that we can observe from this infinite sum of terms. The dot, dot, dot goes on forever. We're not just adding 5 or 10 terms. How are we going to do that? Well, we need to go to that direction where we can find some kind of first term and some kind of common ratio, and then show that the absolute value of that ratio is less than 1. Okay, well, this isn't a section of condensing logarithms, so that should give you a hint as to how to start this problem if you're just doing your homework and you see this pretty challenging problem come up. So, we could look at this as maybe showing this as a log of the square root of 5 divided by the fourth root of 5, and then have that that term, that single logarithm term after the condensing where it's subtraction, and then do some kind of, hey, well, now you're going to add by another exponent, so let's do some kind of multiplication. But you can try that sort of standard condensing of the logarithm if you like, but we do see that each one of these terms has a log of 5, and then there's a power that's applied to that log of 5, and it changes from a power of 1/2 to a 1/4 to a 1/8 to a 1/16. 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, 1/16. It kind of seems like the index of these radicals is changing by a multiple of 2 or multiple of 1/2, however you want to look at it. So I think we're going to be better here if we don't try and condense this immediately, but instead actually expand it a little bit. And we're going to write this as the log of 5 to the 1/2 minus the log of 5 to the 1/4. Now I'm walking us through this problem and kind of just saying, hey, maybe you don't want to condense this right away and show that this is the log of square root of 5 divided by the fourth root of 5 and then multiply that by the eighth root of 5. Hey, look, I've already done all the homework in the book I'm going to teach out of that I'm preparing this all for. And I made this example. So you're going to do some things and realize it's kind of going in an ugly direction and just reset. And so you're not going to think of, oh, every term has a common factor of log of 5. Let's get that out of there. It's going to take work, but this is how we're going to take a look at it. So we have then plus the log of 5 to the 1/8 power minus the log of 5 to the 1/16, and then plus, and that just goes on forever. Now, even though the sum of these terms goes on forever, we see that log of 5 showing up. We still can't kind of bring it out or factor it out because it has the base of 5 has these powers that are changing every new term. But now we can use that power property of logarithms to bring the 1/2, the 1/4, the 1/8, and the 1/16 out front and write this as 1/2 times the log of 5 minus 1/4 times the log of 5 plus 1/8 times the log of 5 minus 1/16 times the log of 5 and so on and so on. Now each of these terms has a common factor, and it truly is a common factor now, not with radicals of different indexes or powers that are constantly changing, but we can factor a log of 5 out of each of the terms in this series. Again, a sum of an infinite number of terms. So we're going to factor out that log of 5 and have our 1/2 minus 1/4 plus 1/8 minus 1/16 plus dot dot dot. Now before we finish this and we close down this video, If you've watched a lot my channel for a long time, or maybe you haven't, hopefully you're a new subscriber and a new viewer of mine to help you go through your math courses. This is something that IB likes to do, which I started teaching in the International Baccalaureate program a few years ago, where you have to be ready. You have to have all of the tools that you learned in your past and be able to pull them out just like that and apply them where appropriate. So even though we're talking about condensing and expanding logarithms, it doesn't mean that you're not going to observe some kind of pattern from another concept, maybe an entire different math class, show up in this particular problem, and you need to be ready to recognize that. So what's going on inside this parentheses, because now we just have a log of 5 outside, and we've actually moved away from the realm of logarithms here, and we're analyzing the sum of this infinite geometric series. And the common ratio can be found by doing a little bit of back division, -1/4, divided by +1/2 is going to be an R value, which is equal to -1/2. And I'm just showing that work, sort of the back division if you didn't see it. But yes, there is a multiplication of -1/2 to create each of these new terms in what is now we're being recognized as a geometric series, because we have that constant ratio of -1/2. And so again, we're trying to evaluate the series. We're trying to find what is the numerical value that the sum of these infinite terms approaches. It's never really going to be exactly this value, but it's going to get closer and closer and closer as you add more terms into this series. Well, log of 5 is a constant. So now for what we have inside of the parentheses, let me get a different color here, of this infinite geometric series, we're going to have S is equal to a(1), the first term, which is going to be 1/2. And then we're going to divide that by 1 minus the value of R. Well, the value of R is -1/2, and yes, indeed, probably should write this down. -1/2 is indeed less than 1. So we have met the condition for the geometric series formula to actually give us that infinite sum. That's going to be 1/2/(1 + 1/2) is 3/2, which is equal to 1/3. Well, that's just this the value that this sum is going to approach inside this parentheses. That has another factor in front of it of log of 5. So this final answer is equal to 1/3 times the log of 5. And let me just check my work in case I did something silly. Actually, this is fine. If maybe you're doing a multiple choice question and you don't see this as one of your choices, that might translate into the log of 5 to the 1/3, or in other words, the log of the third root of 5. Either one of these answers are perfectly fine. Any one of these three answers, really, honestly, are perfectly fine. It just depends on if you're doing a multiple choice question, what form is the choice in. So that is the end of my second example. That is the end of this video. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go to your homework.